The great greening is upon this land. It happens fast. What the heck are those things? Oh, ants. Ants are farming something on this spruce. Okay. The nut pine here wants to live. Look at. This is a hazelnut I planted. It's coming. There's a bunch of them in here. There's another one in that cage. It's coming. Right there. Crab apple that's gonna produce fruit. I planted these red osier dogwood in here for the deer to eat. But they had an easy winter, so they didn't eat them down to the ground like they did the year before. Well, maybe not down to the ground, but definitely down. This right here is a Cornelian cherry. There's another one in that cage. Here's one behind me. Two Cornelian cherries are necessary for cross-pollination, and there's three there. I might have planted 10 in here. And there may be some other ones that are just small, being hidden by the weeds every year. Sooner or later, they take their chance. Aronia, and I planted some service berries in here with them, and there's ants in there too, look at that. Ooh, mosquitoes, they're getting me. Now the red clover's coming up. It's doing okay, we got deer in here visiting. This is the clay dome. Oh, look, I planted some elephant garlic in here. How about that? That's for the hummingbirds. The elephant garlic makes such a nice flower head, and it lasts such a long time. Oh, here's a hascap that made it. It died back, and this little bitty thing, couldn't see it. There's another one right here. It's coming. The deer aren't grazing it down, so that's positive. Crabgrass is coming in, and goldenrod. The deer will eat it for a little while. There's white clover in here, and chicory. Don't see a lot of chicory leaves. They're grabbing that. Looks like a beet. I planted a whole bunch of garden seed. Oh, no, that's a chicory, I think. Yep. They didn't graze that down. I got spring onions in here. And annual winter rye. So I'm believing this is the winter rye. It's always kind of curly when it's starting up. That looks like a goldenrod. And then these are in the winter, or the spring onions. That's an interesting combination, along with the wild plants. I planted showy gold. I planted. This might be the showy goldenrod. I threw some seeds here on this edge. I hope so. Wild carrots. People think those are invasive, but they break the soil up really nice, especially this clay. But I didn't plant them. It's not my fault. And I didn't. They just come. They just show up. I spent a lot of time planting a lot of spring onion bulbils in here. And looks like we got good recruitment. The tops are dying back already, so sign of some element that's locked up in this clay. I think we've had enough rain, but that's okay. They can die back. They're still going to enrich the soil. These little fingers I planted different plants in. I don't see much. The elderberry's coming up. It's in the cage. Have to give it a chance. Parsnip seed in there. Winterberry made the wintergreen made the trip. That's a nanny berry in the cage. It's alive. There was a wind and a snowstorm that happened together and broke a lot of tops off the balsam fir. I dragged the tops over here and I stuck them in these fingers of the pond. Tadpole protection. You can see the tops broke off. Self-pruning. Well, I planted white salsify in here. That's one of the seeds. I just had extra seeds and I just threw them in here. So hopefully that goes to seed, spreads its seed around. That's a wild raspberry right there, the condom blossom. Puffery, did I say that? It's all those broad leaves there, that's all chicory. Excellent. That'll work with this clay. I don't know what that is. I got the mosquito brigade following me. Uh-oh. Another nanny berry that's doing pretty good. We got some of the clovers growing into this little stretch. See a lot of wild carrots growing in there too. I said to myself last winter, if I top this crab apple tree, it's gonna blossom. You can see right in there, I cut that lead off. And sure enough, it's going to blossom. The largest Chickasaw plum on the property, and it's deciding to blossom. Lots of them are blossoming on the property this year. I think that's a Antonovka apple. That's the tallest apple tree. This is a hugel culture here of white ash that I buried under the soil. And there's a black locust right there growing. And I think between the hugel culture and the nitrogen from the black locust is the reason why these are the fastest growing trees on the property right here. Last year at this time, the landscape was dried out. It stayed dried for quite some 6-7 weeks where we begin to get a little rain. This year, so far, we've had rain on a regular basis, and 3-4 days from now there's more rain predicted. This oak seedling right there is a cross between a burr and a white oak, and they planted it here as a companion to this one that's grown really tall. It's all of 20 feet now, I think. I planted that as an acorn in the year 2000. And it did similar. 5-6 years, it just stayed little like that. Then all of a sudden it started to grow. I think this is the year it's going to grow. I'm going to get a cage. I don't want the deer nipping on it or bucks rubbing their antlers on it in the fall. I'm under the belief this is a crab apple. And the belief is going to be tested this year. Fertility is taking over this vernal pool. It's just awesome. Here are the red osier dogwood sticks that I put into the ground this time last year. And they are growing, even through that drought last year. There's been enough moisture content in this clay, held in this clay. They give them their leg up they needed. Look at even this little bitty one. Mountain ash that I was certain had died. But look at sending out shoots out of its roots. Excellent. A couple of weeks ago I transplanted Siberian peaches from the garden beds up by the cabin to this little clay soil here, and I don't know how many are going to live. It looks like every single one of them putting out leaves. These are tough plants. We'll see. One hidden in here. Deer haven't found them yet, but I want the deer to chomp on them a few times. There's a study that shows that the saliva of deer actually triggers a growth response. So, let's do it. It has been caged. See the cage? You can see little green leaves in the middle here. And I surrounded the whole thing with balsam fir tops that were broke off in a snow windstorm this winter. That'll reduce evaporation around the tree, and off it goes. Should get another one right in here, right in the front. Yeah, permaculture people have this thing about woody mulch. To the nth degree. This is a special cherry tree that's living. I was told I can't grow them in my clay soil. You ain't gonna grow them there either. Well, I think there's like 5 of them that are alive out of 25. Another of these special cherries that won't grow here. This one is doing very well. I'm caught. There. Rip my mosquito suit yet again. Serviceberry. There's beetles that are doing something with it. See them? Last year this little bush didn't have any berries. The year before it did. It looks like we're going to have even more this year. On this property would be considered a massive black locust tree. They normally die before then, before this. All of them, except for this one. This one keeps living. And it has sent out a lot of suckers. You can see one in the background there amongst the black walnuts. But an interesting observation is, here's a black walnut that was planted, geez, not even, be like 2017, 2016, 2017. I'd have to look it up. Look at how thick it is, growing in amongst these black locusts. It rivals and maybe is even thicker than some of those I planted in 2013. Black locust is preparing the soil for these black walnuts. I've got black walnuts planted, you know, apart from the black locusts, that aren't even a third of this thickness. This one isn't too bad. Not too bad. But still, the ones planted in the black locust thicket are growing faster, growing thicker. Growing thicker faster. Thicker quicker. I transplanted this Nanking cherry here. Doesn't look vigorous, but it's alive. I'm gonna make sure I get a pail up here and throw a pail of water and its roots. I'm just walking along, minding my own business, and I see this little tree here growing. It sure looks like an apricot to me. I never noticed it. I planted northern apricots from Coldstream Farm up here at least 10 years ago. I planted 50. There aren't very many that are alive. I'm believing this to be one of them that is alive. Better cage it. I wonder what this is. A shallow area carved out of the clay, fed by spring rainwater, and now it's turning into a fertile soup. Some people would call this eutrophication, but that's not how I consider it. I would call it beautrification. Think about all the life that's going to live here. And I am growing wild rice. That's what the cages are for. It hasn't come up yet, but I've got a little area right here that's cleared out and planted seed. I think this area still grow a crop of rice this year. But if I keep moving, clearing out, moving, I think I can keep the wild rice growing here. Otherwise, wild rice is like a domesticated plant. You know, if you don't take care of it, it goes away. Hinge cutting this tag elder clump, I was hoping to get coverage beyond the clump itself. And you can see the leaves now are growing. I didn't think it was going to make it because we had heavy snow and it really knocked it down. And what it does is it pinches off right there to bark. It looks like it's able to, I don't know if they call it repair it. But all these leaves now are cover for frogs or whatever else that wants to come up here to the edge of the pond. Going to be harder for those big beak birds to hunt them. I am transplanting more hazelnuts. And there's my tool of choice. I trimmed them off a little bit. I think they're going to be good. I want to look at this. Hey, I've never picked this asparagus. I think it's time I take one.